Today we're going to look at some very complex forms of human behavior. But first we're going to get into the evolutionary background of behavior. And we want to look at a field called behavioral ecology, which is concerned with the adaptive significance or the evolutionary advantage of certain forms of behavior. We've already seen examples of this with sexual selection, where female lions preferred males with dark manes and therefore had more surviving offspring. We also saw it when we looked at the evolution of cooperation, and we saw helpers at the nest, and we also saw how social insects work to assist the queen. We want to look now at another trait that's very common in nature, group living. And that, of course, is essential when you start thinking about social behavior. And we're going to use that framework as we move towards an understanding of the evolution of human society. And as we do this, I'm also going to be introducing you to some ideas from a rather controversial field known as evolutionary psychology. Why is it that individuals often come together to live in groups? Why is it that they're social? We see this in all kinds of different organisms, whether it's birds, fish, mammals. We see that in many cases, a bird might have a huge desire to live in a flock, but a related species may be quite a solitary individual. Some fish live alone, others are highly gregarious. Why is it? When we see this kind of repetition of the same pattern in multiple different species, group living in so many different forms, we have a clue that it's probably adaptive. There's probably an evolutionary advantage from living in a group. To get used to the idea that living in groups might actually be an adaptation, I want to focus on predators and their prey. There are many different ideas for why it is that prey might want to live in groups to protect themselves against predators. First is called the dilution effect, where an individual is less likely to be chosen by a predator if it's in a group. Here's a simple example. Here we have a fish that is a predator, and it wants to eat a little fish. Okay? So here we have a little fish who is all by itself. Now, if it encounters a predator, and the predator decides to hunt, its risk of being chosen is really high. Like 100%, okay? But if you're in a group of four, right, and this predator can only grab one out of your group, okay, then, hey, your individual risk is only one in four, okay? So there's a big advantage to you in avoiding predation if you lived in a group. And this goes on no matter how big the group. So if the predator can only choose one prey at a time, your individual risk of being eaten decreases down with the size of the group, so just 1 over n. There are a lot of animals that rely on the dilution effect that reduces their individual risks of being chosen by predators. One of the most famous examples are the wildebeest of the Serengeti, where we have 1.5 million individuals. Now, they are incredible in the way that the females all give birth over a very short window of time. There's about 400,000 females that get pregnant any given year, and they all give birth within a single 3-week window. Now, during that period of time, their calves are very highly vulnerable. The first few days after birth, the baby's very wobbly on its feet, but it only takes 3 or 4 days for it to gather strength and to be just as difficult to catch as an adult. And so, yes, the newborns may be easily captured, but there's tens of thousands of them on any given day, far more babies than there are lions to eat them. And so most of the babies are going to escape predation. So they're swamping the predators. That's a classic case of the dilution effect. Now, another way that we get an advantage from living in groups is called the selfish herd, where individuals within the herd don't just rely on a safety of numbers, but they actually behave in a way that reduces their individual risk of being chosen by the predator. So in this case, we have a wildebeest with her calf in a herd with a bunch of other wildebeest. And then this is still in the phase where the calf is relatively vulnerable to predation, and a hyena could easily catch it. But the cow is smart. So she actually puts herself on the opposite side of the herd from the predator, so there's a chance that the predator won't see her. So she uses her companions as cover. Another way that we see that prey operate once they're in groups to reduce their chances of being captured is called the confusion effect. Now, this assumes there will be an attack, but it might not succeed because the prey confuse the predator. So let's go back to our fish. Let's say we have a single fish and the, you know, it doesn't want to get caught, right? So it's going to make an evasive maneuver. So it's going to, so don't catch me, ah! But it's easy, okay, for the predator to keep its focus on that one erratic prey and it catches it, okay? But now we've got four in a group and they're all over the place. Where'd they go, okay? Oh, and they missed again, you see? You just can't focus, you're distracted. So the risk of being captured in an attack is much lower, okay? Now, this confusion effect depends on similarity, okay? And now I want you to do is to imagine back in middle school or high school, and who'd you hang out with, okay? Were you a little odd, you know? Were you an odd individual that maybe kind of leaned more towards the goth end of the spectrum? Did you find that all you goths kind of dressed alike, right? And, you know, maybe you're a jock, and so you hung out with the other jocks, and you all kind of dressed alike, right? And either way, you didn't want to be picked out by your teacher or the police or anything. So if you're all dressed exactly the same, okay, the predator's like, I can't tell them apart. All these kids, they look the same, okay? But if you dress differently, okay, if you show an individual style, okay, it's easy for the predator to keep a focus on you and catch you, okay? So the confusion effect depends on similarity, and so this probably explains a lot why there is conformity in social groups. So what we've seen with these examples is that individuals who are prey reduce their risk from being captured by predators by living in groups.